the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is amazing grace. This is a failing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing. All that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered. Sing it out. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King. Conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. All that you've done for me.
We have four candidates who are going to be baptized. Baptism is really the Christian way of letting you know and letting the world know which side you're on and what you think of Jesus Christ. And so we are really delighted to have Dicey, to have Kaylee, Tinley, and Justice, who are here to let you know what they think of Jesus Christ and his role in their life. And so we're going to get to it. Dicey, come on into the sauna. It's great. This is as easy as it gets. Dicey has been in this church, I don't know, a year and a half, 2 years maybe? Okay. Well, we're glad that you came. This is one of my favorite people. She cooked me one of the best, or baked me one of the best pies for pastor appreciation. Cakes. Yeah. So I'm really grateful the Lord brought you here. And we're grateful for what the Lord has done in your life, Dicey. If you want to say anything, you can. If not, you let the baptism speak for you. All right.
I'll do this like this. All right.
Don't go before I go. Dicey, in the name of the Father and Son and Holy Spirit, I baptize you, and it's my pleasure to baptize you. Amen. Okay. I'm about to baptize Tinley White, and I asked Tinley why she wanted to be baptized, and she said, because I want to be clean. And she went on to explain more of what she meant, and she's not talking about literal clean, but she understands what it means to come to Jesus Christ. And Tinley, I'm so glad that I get to baptize you today. This is an honor. You might be the President of the United States someday, and I can say I baptize you. Tinley, in the name of the Father and Son, it's my honor to be here. This is Kaylee Myers, the daughter of Steve and Nikki. And Kaylee, I'm glad you're doing this. This is, again, you could be president, and I could say that I did. I'm glad for what Jesus has done in your life, and I'm glad that you love him so much that you're going to do this. All right? In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Praise him.
Amen.
This is Justice Harrell. Would her, some of her family and friends, would you like to stand? We have some of those. All right, look here. Jesus said in Mark chapter 10, verse 14, suffer the little children and forbid them not, for of such is the kingdom of heaven. Suffer the little children, he said, to come unto me. And forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of heaven. You know, I think sometimes we may unnecessarily complicate salvation. So when a child comes and says, I've asked God to forgive me of my sins and invited Jesus Christ into my life, do we believe them or not? There's a building out at a campground called Hooten Hall. Some of you know that. It's named after J.T. Hooten, one of our great pioneer pastors. He preached the gospel for about 70 years. I sat on a platform with him one time years ago, and I asked Brother Hooten, I said, how old were you when you were saved? And he said, I was 6 years old. So we believe them. Amen? All right. This is Justice, and she has accepted Christ as her Savior and asked God to forgive her of her sins. And so we're going to baptize her in the name of God the Father, Jesus Christ the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
You are my strength. Though my heart is weak, you won't let go. You take my place on this battlefield. You go before. You're my sword and shield. I'm not a always have.
God, you're our defense this morning.
Yeah. Life is like a mountain railroad with an engineer that's brave. We must make the run successful from the cradle to the grave. Watch the curves that fills the tunnels. Never fall.
Chapter 6 this morning, and I should say before we continue that in the first few chapters of the book of Romans, which many believe is the greatest theology that the world has ever known, but in these first few chapters, Paul has been writing something that is very controversial to his listeners in that era. He is saying essentially that salvation is not something that you work for. It's not achieved, it's received. And so, for instance, in Romans chapter 3, he talks about how we're all sinners, we're all in need of salvation. And then in chapter 4, verse 5, he says, now to him, and this is King James, now to him who worketh not, but believeth on him who justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted as righteousness. And so there you have a tremendous statement. He says, to him who does not work for it, to him who will simply put faith in Jesus Christ, they can be saved and born again. And so he's working off this, again, very controversial ideal that it really flies in the face of all other belief systems, all other faiths, in saying that salvation, again, has to be given by God to you. You can't achieve it through your works. But then comes the obvious question that people have had for 2,000 years, which is this. Okay, so if faith achieves salvation, if salvation is a gift, if it's a free gift of God, then does it really matter how I live anymore? I mean, if it's free, then that means I can do anything that I want, right? And so Paul then moves in chapter 6, where we're going to be looking to answering that question, which again seems to flow out of the logic of chapters 1 through 5 to many who would hear it. But in fact, Paul says that it's really not a very logical way to proceed. Verse 1 of chapter 6 says this.
What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Certainly not! Exclamation point. How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? Or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore we are buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in the newness of life. For if we have been united together in the likeness of his death, certainly we also shall be in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, and that we should no longer be slaves of sin. For he who has died has been freed from sin. Amen. So again, Paul is working off this ideal, and he's saying salvation is not achieved, it is received. You have to take it by grace. And again, that flies in the face of much of what we are taught in our culture. From the very earliest times in our life, in my life, it's the kid who gets the best grades that gets the A's. If you get enough A's, you get to get up on graduation in the ceremony and give a speech to boards, everybody. You're valedictorian. And then if you go and you work in a job, if you make the most sales, you get the promotion. Everything in our culture says achieving gets the good stuff, but here in the gospel, grace gets the good stuff. But Paul says that just because you are saved by grace, you ought not then assume that what you do doesn't matter, because salvation is to get you to heaven. That's right, but salvation is also to save you here on earth. And he says, you and I are slaves, and you and I need to be delivered. Sin is a major issue with Jesus, and in this whole scripture, sin is a predator. It's a leprosy in our minds. It's a prison house that we are in, and God cares about us, and surely he wants us to be saved from the prison of sin, from the chains of sin. We can't serve him until we are freed from sin, and so certainly he wants us to serve him, so he intends to free us from sin. And in fact, sometimes in scripture, when we talk about being saved by grace, really what we're talking about is being saved from sin by grace. Oftentimes people say, well, you're saved by grace so you can go to heaven. You're saved not based on your works. But also, when you read the book of Romans, particularly Romans chapter 8, verses 1 through 5, when we talk about being saved by grace, we're talking about being really delivered from sin by grace. Not about heaven, but it really is an extension of the conversation of sin. I mean, imagine going to a doctor, and you go in, and you have a cancer, or you have another very serious illness. The doctor will look at you and he will say, or she will say, something of the equivalent of, you've got to be saved by grace. Because they'll look at you, and if you've got a cancer, they may very well say to you, listen, what you have, you're not going to be able to work out and fix what you have. You're not going to be able to go on a multivitamin and fix what you have. You're not going to be able to de-stress your life and fix what you have. You're not going to be able to yoga your way out of what you have. The only way you're going to get out of or get rid of what you have is by an act of grace. Somebody from the outside is going to have mercy on you, and they're going to have to do an internal work in your life. That's how bad the situation is. Now, when Jesus comes, he says that's what sin's like. And you can't be delivered from sin apart from him coming from the outside, doing a work in your heart, a work in your life. It's got to come through grace. And he intends, again, to take us to heaven, yes, but he also intends to free us here on earth from all things that beset us. Now, what sins does God plan on saving us from? What sins does he plan to save us from? What sins bind us? And the answer is All of them. All of them. You know, I don't think that I would preach if I didn't believe that. I mean, I certainly wouldn't hang around Celebrate Recovery if I didn't believe that Jesus Christ can take a person with a chemical addiction and deliver them from the addiction. I wouldn't hang around and preach too much here if I didn't believe that he could take a person addicted to alcohol and deliver them from alcohol. I wouldn't do a lot of preaching. I don't think I might even quit preaching if I didn't believe that he could take a person who had been abused as a child and do a work in their life so that they were able to move past that abuse and maybe even forgive those who had abused them. Now, I believe God can do that. I believe that he wants to do that. And if he can do the big ones, certainly he can do the little ones. If he can deliver somebody with chemical dependency and hatred their whole life, somebody who's been abused for 30 years, but now they're able to forgive those in the past, he can certainly deal with a gossiping tongue, an envious spirit, a proudful heart. He can do the smaller ones if he can do the big ones. And if he wants to do the big ones, certainly he would want to do the smaller ones. Now, I get tired of hearing people say, well, that's just the way I am. I mean, I'm just the kind of person who speaks my mind. That's the way God created me. I'm just the kind of person who speaks my mind. I just can't control my thoughts. If I have a thought, I just have to speak it. Well, listen, if God can't help you control your mind, quit getting on your husband because he can't control his eyes. That's just the way he was made. If you can't control what you say and how you say it, don't get on your husband when you're sitting in the mall and a pretty girl goes by and he does this number. Don't. It's just the way he got made. But if he can be cleansed of his pornography, you can be cleansed of your gossiping, mean tongue. I mean, listen, if you can't be delivered from greed, which causes you to go out and run up bills on your charge card, you don't have a hope of paying. If you can't be delivered from that, when you're cleaning your son's room and you find a little bit of that stuff between his mattresses that Willie Nelson sort of smokes to get ready to sing, leave him alone. Forgive him. If you can't be cleansed from your stuff, he's just a deadhead. He was born that way. There's nothing he can do. Just leave him alone. Let your husband be on the computer all hours of the night. Just leave him alone. If that's the way you're made, leave everybody else alone. Maybe that's the way they were made. But if God can cleanse the guy with pornography, if God can take the chemical dependency away from your teenage son, he can take your attitude away from you. And if he wants to take the pornography away and the chemical dependency away, he wants to take your attitude away from you. So God came to cleanse from all sin. The big ones, yeah, but the little ones, yeah, that too. In fact, there's a word in the Bible, if you can put that word up. It's practically genesia. You see the word Genesis in there, don't you? It means new beginning. It's a word that's only in the Bible in two places. It's an important word, though, in Greek philosophy. The Stoics talked a lot about the practically genesia. What the Stoics believed was this. They believed that the world went through endless cycles, and the world would start, and it would get so bad at times that it would just have to be burned up, it would have to be burned over, it would have to be paleogenesia, it would have to be burned over and restarted. And so they believe that in time we go through endless cycles of paleogenesia. Now what's interesting is that Jesus picks up that word in Matthew chapter 19, verse 28. So Jesus said to them, "Assuredly I say to you that in the regeneration, in the paleogenesia, when the Son of Man sits on his throne of his glory, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel." Now we're not absolutely sure what Jesus means, whether he means the same thing as the Stoics, that the time will come when the earth will be burned over. 2 Peter chapter 3 seems to imply that the earth will be burned over, it will be consumed. And then you have a lot of writing in the Bible about new heavens and new earth. And a lot of theologians think that the time will come when it's all said and done, that the earth, that the universe will be cleansed, and that heaven and earth will merge together so that you could go between the two. We just don't know, but it's interesting that Jesus says in the Paglia Genesia, in the regeneration, after all of that, I will sit on my throne and judge the people. Now, there's another place that word Paglia Genesia is used. Look at it in Titus chapter 3, verse 5. Not by works of righteousness which we have done, not saved by works, but according to his mercy, he saved us through the washing of Paglia Genesia and the renewing of the Holy Spirit. Now, that's interesting. He says the day is going to come when there is going to be a burning over. Again, we don't know exactly what Jesus is saying. I'm assuming that he's sort of saying what the Stoics are saying, which may not be so. But he's saying it's all going to be renewed. It's all going to be reborn. It's all going to be started again. And he says, but the same power that's going to do that to the universe then is doing that to you right now. The Holy Spirit is burning over. He is recreating something brand new in your life. That's what he plans to do. C.S. Lewis put it this way, and I paraphrase. He said, the major problem that God has with us is not that we want too much, but that we want too little. It's not that we want too much, it's that we want too little. He says, we are content to be like children making mud pies, not understanding what it's like to have a holiday at the beach. We're content with the mud pies. Most people look at their lives, and if they have enough money, and they have a nice love life, and if they're sort of well thought of, and they have a sculptured body, that's all that they want out of life. That's all that they're seeking. That's all that they're craving. But God is coming, and he's saying, I aim to free you from sin. I aim to do something completely revolutionary in your life. I aim to send the same power that raised Jesus from the dead into hearts and lives, and I aim to radically reconfigure them as individuals. That's what he wants to do in your life. He wants to change you radically. Listen, do you know what's better than money? Do you know what's better than money? Not being controlled or craving money. That's the better thing. Godliness with contentment is greater gain. See, listen, most people can make money if that's all they want to do in life. I mean, you can steal it. You can marry it, which is probably harder than stealing it. Or are you going to just spend your whole life pursuing it? Money is fairly easy to come by in America if that's what you really want. But godliness with contentment is rarer. It's more valuable. It's easier. It's a lot harder to walk around saying, you know what, I'm content with what I have. I got billions of billions and billions. I'm a joint heir with Jesus. I got lots of stuff in my, not Swiss bank account, but in my heavenly bank account. I can penny pinch a little bit down here. I'm fine. God has given me everything that I need. God wants you to be not a person so much with money, but a person who doesn't need money. You're shooting too low if you're just shooting at money. You are. People want a great love life. You know what's better than a great love life? Yeah. Not having to have a great love life to be happy. See, that's a lot better. You're shooting too low if you just want the great love life. It's better because whatever you crave that much will control you and it'll run you ragged. It's better not to need it. You know what's better than having a great reputation? Not really caring what people think of you. That's a lot better. Yeah, a great reputation is nice, but not being controlled by people's opinions of you, that's actually a lot better. That's a lot more freeing. You know what's better than a sculpted body, a healthy body? It's this absolute, complete assurance in your heart that when this body dies, I have a new body waiting for me. That is much better. And what Jesus wants to do is to revolutionize yourself, to get you off the money and the relationship so much, and to get you off what people think about you, and to get you off this sculpting mentality that's taken over 21st century America, and to get you free. He wants to free you from those bonds. He wants to deliver you up so that those are not controlling forces in my life or in your life. He wants to pagli genesea us. Now, how does he do that? What's verse 5? Right? Verse 5 says, he came to unite with us. Notice this. For if you have been united together in the likeness of his death, certainly you shall be in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man is crucified, he's dead, the body of sin might be destroyed and done away with, it might be pagli genesia, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. So how are we not slaves to sin? Well, the old body is sort of crucified, it's done away with. Those old desires are killed off in our life. Well, how are they killed off in our life? Because we have been united with Jesus Christ. That's how it happens. The imagery there is, of course, of baptism. He says as a person goes down into the water, symbolically, they're dying with Jesus. And as Jesus was raised from the grave, so they are symbolically being raised from their old lives. You are united with Jesus in baptism. And by the way, I should say this, we're having a baptism next week as well. We have another gentleman that's going to be baptized. We want you to be baptized. When the Bible talks about baptism, it's talking about being a Christian. They were united. The people in the Bible who became Christians got baptized, and it's simply a way of talking about the Christians. Those who are baptized are Christians. Listen, the Bible knows nothing about a Christian who hasn't been baptized. You need to be baptized. The majority of Christianity, the majority of Christian expressions really do believe you can't go to heaven without being baptized. We don't teach it, but the Bible gets very close. That's why so many denominations do infant baptisms, because they believe you can't go to heaven if you haven't been baptized. There are denominations who believe that you're not saved until you're baptized. Now again, we don't believe that. But the Bible gets very close to almost saying that. And that's why hundreds of millions of Christians actually believe that. It's very important that you be baptized. Now, he's talking about baptism. And he says, as you were united with Jesus, and as you are united with Jesus in this life, and as you are united with Jesus in his resurrection, if you understand that, if you understand that unity, then the power of sin can begin to break in your life. What does it mean to be united with Jesus? It means a lot of different things. It takes a long time to unpack it. But let me just share one thing with you. One thing with you. Because I am united with Jesus, what that means is that his past is now more important than my past. He died back there. I'm united in that death. And that death in his past is more important than my past. See, I got a lot of stuff maybe in my past. I got some stuff I'm guilty of. I've made some bad decisions. I've done some wrong. I've got maybe a lot of things that haven't gone right in my life. I've got sins back there. I've got some guilt that has resulted from that sin. I got a past. You got a past. But because I am united with Jesus Christ, his past is now more important than my past, because in his past, he went to Calvary to die for my past. And his past triumphs over my past because I have been united with him. You know what? His present is more important than my present because I am united with him. Maybe in your present, you've got some trials and tribulation. Maybe you got some hard places. Maybe you've got some struggles in your present. Maybe you got some real concerns in your present. Maybe you're in the valley of the shadow of death in your present, but you know where he is presently? He is seated at the right hand of the Father in all power and all control. When he left this earth to go to heaven, he said, all authority has been given to me on heaven and on earth. I can deal with my present because I know about his present. He's in control. He's reigning. He has the power. He has the authority. He has the ability to deliver me. He has the ability to stay with me going through whatever I'm going through. And so his present trumps my present. I have my present, but I'm also united with him in his present. And that makes a difference in my present. And his future is more important than my future. See, my future, you know, depending on how I wake up, what side of bed I get up on, my future doesn't always look so rosy. I mean, I'm 40, man. That's half dead. And I ain't gonna make it to 80. And here's the thing about being 40. I'm serious right now. The last 40 years have been pretty good, so to speak. Been as good. I mean, they've been good. But the next 40, I'm the youngest of five kids. If I live long enough, I'm going to have to bury my whole family. All right, I'm serious. So parents, I'm the youngest by 8 years. I haven't had to bury anybody yet. The next 40 years, I'm standing in a lot of graves coming up. If I live long enough, I'm going to be one of those guys like some of you guys saying, most of the people I know are on the other side. I don't know many people left here on earth. That's the next 40 years for me. The next 40 years, if my family genetics are any predictor of what's going to happen to me, the next 40 years is going to be a lot of visits to heart doctors and urologists. It's my next 40 years. And that's assuming that I live 40 more years, because most people in my family don't live to be 80 years old. We drop dead of heart attacks in our 60s and 70s. So, if you think about it, the past has been really nice. The next 40 years is going to have its fair share of obstacles ahead. It's been great, but there's a lot of sadness in my next 40 years that I'll have to go through, and many of you have walked that road. So, depending on how I wake up, my next 40 years, my future doesn't always seem so bright, but you know what his future is? Yeah, he's going to reign forever. Yeah, he's coming back. He's going to deliver us up. He's going to take us with him. He's going to reign. He's reigning now, and he'll just continue to reign on into the future. The only issue is whether we're going to be with him at the throne or whether we're going to be down here, but his future looks great. And because his future looks great and I'm united with him, I don't have to be so worried about my future, because I'm going to be with him. I'm a joint heir. I'm a co-heir with Jesus Christ. My last breath here will be my first breath with him. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And Paul said that it would probably be better to go on to be with the Lord, because there's more trials and tribulations here. So because his future is eternally reigning, I can deal with my future. See, I have been united with him. Now, what does all of that do in my life and in your life? It changes us, and that's just one aspect. His past trumps my past. His present trumps my present. His future trumps my future. And because I can be united with him, what that does is very practically, it begins to root out the reasons why I might even think about sinning, turning against God. See, you don't sin for no reason. You don't just don't up and sin. There's stuff deep down. There's roots to the behaviors. The behaviors are the fruit. There's roots that produce the fruit. And you'll never deal with the fruit of your life until you deal with the root of your life. That's the problem with legalism. Legalism just tries to change the fruit on the tree. I mean, legalism is like the theologically equivalent of trying to put makeup on bullet wounds. That's about what legalism is like. It just tries to cover up the outside, but the problem is deep down in the ground. It's deep inside. Until you get that fixed, you don't get the fruit fixed. And when you are united with Jesus and when that becomes a part of your life, you know what that does? It starts to cleanse you at the root. See, why do people sin? Why do people sin? They feel very alone in life. They feel like if I don't help myself, nobody else will help myself. If I don't stand up for me, nobody else is going to stand up for me. If I don't seek my rights, nobody else is going to seek my rights. Nobody's really in my corner. If I don't do it myself, if I don't push hard, if I don't knock people out of my way, it's not going to get done. They feel very alone in life. And that oftentimes drives hard personalities, hard words, greed even. Greed comes out of a lot of aloneness that you feel because if I don't save this money, if I don't collect as much as I can, I'm going to get to the end of my life and there's going to be nobody to take care of me. I'm so alone in my life. But I'm united with Jesus, man. He owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. I don't need to feel so alone. I don't need to push so hard. I don't need to knock people out of my way. Jesus can supply my needs. I'm united with him. You know why people make sometimes dumb decisions? It's not aloneness, but it's loneliness. Loneliness. I think a lot of people get into really bad relationships just because they're lonely. They don't have anybody. They're sad. I think people get into some habits, some dependencies because they feel very alone, and that loneliness creates some depression, and you don't tend to make really good decisions when you're a very lonely person. You tend to make needy decisions, and needy decisions oftentimes get you into bad situations. But if Jesus sticks closer than a brother, if I am conscious that I'm not lonely, I have the one. Listen, I'm the only one whose opinion matters in my life. I have Jesus Christ in my life. You know what that should do? It should start to rid us of that internal loneliness and despair because I've been united with him. People make a lot of bad decisions out of guilt. They do. I think probably most of the time that you and I struggle with our parenting sometimes is out of guilt. We spend too much, and deep down we feel like maybe we haven't given our kids everything that they need, so we spoil them. And maybe, you know, some of the reasons I think maybe we don't discipline like maybe we probably should have is because, you know, I probably created the problems, and I haven't been a good parent anyway, and there's reasons why they probably act the way that they do. And out of that guilt, we sort of let things go. Out of guilt, we let sometimes people run over us, and then when they run over us, we get angry and we have this hostility underneath the surface. But guilt has an impact on your life. It does. But I've been united with Jesus in his past. His past. He died to forgive me of my guilt. If I can ever feel completely innocent before him, if I can ever get to the place that in my heart and mind, my sins have been tossed in the sea of his forgetfulness, if that ever becomes consciously a part of my life, it will change the way I behave. It will affect me at my roots. Does. We struggle with hopelessness sometimes, right? How much of the behavior that we do, again, comes from hopelessness? How much of it comes from low self-esteem? How much of it comes from too high self-esteem, maybe? All of these things, again, if I am united with Jesus Christ, I shouldn't deal with low self-esteem. Because, again, he's the elder brother. He's reigning. I, too, shall reign with him. In my past, he loved me so much he was willing to give his life for me. All of this stuff is cleansing you from low self-esteem, from thinking lowly of yourself. And how many people, again, make such poor decisions based on their esteem issues? I mean, I'm the father of 3 girls. I'm scared to death my girls are going to have these esteem issues that any boy's good enough for them, and whatever they need to do to get a guy, that's what they'll do. Man, you can get into trouble with low self-esteem. How many people take the first drug because they just want to fit in? They just want to be a part. They don't feel like they have anybody. They're alone. They feel bad about themselves. Listen, if you can begin to cleanse all of this stuff at the root, you can begin to change the fruit on the tree. And what Jesus Christ came to do was to change the root that will change the fruit. And he begins by uniting with us. He begins by saying, my past can be your past. What I did back there, the death I died, is for you. It's for your cleansing. It's for your empowerment. You need not carry the guilt. I am reigning now, and you are with me. You need not worry. You need not fear. You need not care about what other people think about you. You need not be concerned about where you're going to get your next meal, because I see, I understand, you're with me. And his future then becomes our future. So we need not be hopeless people. We need not be pessimistic people. We need not be despairing people. We need not be grappling people. You need not sow your wild oats here. Heaven is coming. You're not going to miss out. There's glory ahead. And so if we share with him in his glory, again, that ought to be doing something for us at the roots. He came to unite with us, to destroy who we used to be, so that we might be freed from sin. Amen. Man, question is, how much do you want it? How much do I want it? Right? How much do you want it? How much do we want it? Stand with me, will you? You won't be clean. Listen, until you come to Jesus, hear this while the musicians are coming. You won't be clean until you come to Jesus. People sometimes say, well, I'm going to get this fixed in my life and I'm going to get this worked out and then I'll come to Jesus. That's the logic of saying, hey, I'm going to get my hands washed. I'm going to get my hands really clean and then I'm going to pick up the bar of soap. Or saying, hey, you know what? Let's get the dishes clean and then we'll put them in the dishwasher. Listen, Jesus is the cleansing agent. He is the deliverer from sin. You're not going to do it on your own. You're not going to do it until you come to him. The only hope you have of being cleansed from the things that destroy life, of being delivered, is to come to the deliverer. And Jesus Christ is here to deliver today. Some of you maybe are going through some difficult places in life. Listen, he's united with you. He's with you. You don't walk through the valley of the shadow of death alone. You walk through it, and he is with you today. And maybe some of you would just like to come and pray. Say, Lord, remind me of that. I know it's in the Bible. I know it's true. I just read it. I got it in my head, but I need it in my heart. I need it in my heart. And there's a big difference in having it in your head and having it in your heart. You can be something but not feel like you're something. You can be loved but not feel loved. You might want to just come to Jesus today and say, Jesus, I need you. I know you're there for me. I know you're there. I know you're reigning, but I'm living my life and I'm not living like I know that. Awaken my heart again to what I know in my head is true. Listen, you need not be in despair today. Don't shoot so. Don't shoot low. Shoot high. Shoot high. God is here for you today. Let's sing.
The Savior alone carried the cross for all of my debts. He paid the cost. Salvation complete, now forever.